Hey guys, a very warm welcome to this session. I'm Ankna, your master teacher for social sciences at Vedanta, hoping all of you are doing absolutely amazing. Today, we're going to get started with our new chapter, Lifelines of National Economy. But the good news is that today itself, in this one video, we're going to finish the entire chapter. How awesome is that? So let's get started, guys. Let me quickly remind you about Vedanta Pro subscription. As you know, guys, with this subscription, you will get unlimited live classes, access to all the micro sessions, all your problems of doubts, notes, schedule, language, everything is going to be super sorted, and you're going to get a lot of personalized attentions from all the teachers and class teachers, master teachers in the session itself. All your doubts will be solved right then and there, and then also you will also have the quizzes which will give you in class live performance reports. All you need to do is go on the link given in the description box or that is pinned in the comment section and just follow the steps and choose whichever subscription is the best suited for you. Just remember to use the code AKEPRO because this code will give you access to the discount and you will get discount up to 20%. How awesome is that? Moving on, let's start by discussing the answer to the previous session's question, which is A, Rajasthan. And the people who have answered the fastest are Kiran Nath, Shubhang Jain and Balivansh Pawar. Congrats, my dear bachcha log. I'm so proud of you. The rest of you guys who have not been able to make to the leaderboard, let me inform you quickly and remind you quickly actually that please make sure that whenever you're putting your answers, you're not just putting it in the live chat but in the comment section. And do not forget to subscribe to the channel, guys. Okay, so today, as I told you guys, we're going to finish the entire chapter. So let's not even look at the index and move forward with introduction. So the if I talk about the name of the chapter itself, guys, it says Lifelines of National Economy, right? And you can see that I'm going to talk about transportation. Then you might be thinking that how can transportation be a lifeline of economy? Like, how are these two even related? I mean, we are reading about transportation. The name says national economy, lifelines of national economy. So let's start by answering the question, what do you mean by economy? But economy is just simple words, production and consumption of goods and services and the supply of it, the supply of money in exchange. Change of it, okay? That's basically what builds the economy of any country, okay? But then how will the economy build up? I mean, if I talk about these goods, if I talk about these services, how will it reach from the producers to the consumers? It can never happen without transportation. And here is where the transportation plays, the most important role is transferring, is moving the produced goods from the producers to the consumers. Otherwise, the consumers will never receive it. And if the consumers never receive it, no money will be generated and economy will never develop. Which means this makes the transportation spine of our economy, and that is what helps it develop and build on strong. So always remember, this is how it will act as a lifeline of economy, guys. And who facilitates all of these things? Who facilitates all of this economy, all of this transportation? It is the traders who are producing and, you know, or maybe transferring the goods from producers to consumers. It is them who is helping us in doing this, right? So development of any country can be clearly determined that how much production is happening over there and what is the amount of movement of this production of goods, of services, and the kind of money that it is generating. That is what is meant by economy, right? And because of this transportation only, India, for that matter, any other country has been connected to other countries in terms of goods, culture, languages, whatever. And that is what has now changed the entire world into a big giant village, making transportation, communication, and trade its core, element, essentials of this, wherein they go hand in hand, they go together, because the world in today's date will not exist. The economy in today's days will not sustain or exist without these three things, right? So all of them together are also contributing to India's socio-economic progress by linking India with the entire world. Now let's start by talking about transportation in particular, and then we will move to also communication and trading, okay guys? So transportation, if I guys talk about, can be divided in three major chunks by depending upon the mode of the mode that we are taking to deal with that transportation, to take to transfer through that means. Okay, so it can be through land, it can be through water, or it can be through air. So that defines transportation in three major parts: land, water, and air. Landways, roadways, and airways, right? So these are the three main domains. These are the domains. These are the main three categories. Now, it was not easy to develop all of these three categories or transportation in general. It was not a process of just one single day. No, absolutely not. It took way more longer than one day. In fact, years or decades to develop all of this. It has all been possible because of the development of science and technology, right? Until transportation hit its, peak development, trade was also not really doing very well. So what do we understand by this? If transportation is not there, it will obstruct trading also. So this makes transportation a prerequirement for trading. Now, if you talk about the three means of transportation, which are land, can be divided in further three ways: roadways, railways, and pipelines. Water has inland and overseas, and air has two: domestic and international, public undertaking, and private airlines. And we will discuss all of this in detail going forward. Okay, so let's start with roadways. We have the largest network in the world. I'm not sure if you know that, but I mean, not largest, but one of the largest. We have around 56 kilometers of roads in India itself. But this still, not always people travel by roads. But did you know that it always precedes railways? It is always considered over railways. Why is that? Because which are building roads and maintaining roads is very easy, and it's more cost effective than railways. Although transportation through railways might be comparatively more economical, but its maintenance, its building is going to be more cost consuming. Now, if we talk about the growing importance of roadways, what is making that happen? See, first of all, which I personally feel is very essential and makes it really, really special or important, I would say, is the door-to-door service. Through roads only, we can reach from right one door to the another road. Even if you want to take the waterways, the airways, the railways, whatever, even to reach that station, to the airport, to the port, you would need the roadways, right? You would require the roads to be there. So it ensures the road door-to-door service, which no other transportation means of transportation does. And also, I told you in the beginning itself that the construction of roads and its maintenance, the cost of it is way lesser than anything else. Waterways in itself is cheaper, but then it's not so feasible, right? So, and we will discuss that ahead, so don't worry. But if I talk about in general terms of land, then it's way cheaper than railways, and also the costing is lesser than the pipelines, right? And it doesn't matter what kind of a terrain it is, even if it is a surface of hills and mountains, which is up and down, building roads in such a place through forests, over rivers, water bodies is still comparatively easier than building any other means through land. Remember, I mean, railways and pipelines is what I'm majorly referring to. And this, all of this makes it way economical. Okay, economical. This, all of this makes it very economical. Now, when it comes to classifying roads, bachcha, it has been classified into six major categories in India. Number one being the golden quadrilateral super highway. See, the quadrilateral in itself gives us a picture in mind. What is quadrilateral? It is a closed, enclosed figure with four sides. So that is what the quadrilateral is. It connects the four main metropolitan cities of India: Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai, and Kolkata. But it's not just that it is connecting. It has made a whole new corridor from end to end, right from north to south and right from east to west. North to south, from Srinagar in Jammu and Kashmir to Kanyakumari in Tamil Nadu, and from east to west is connecting Silchar from Assam to Porbandar in Gujarat. And it is maintained and taken care of by the National Highway Authority of India, and is the most super and highest ranked kind of highways, I would tell you, in India. And it is a 6-lane highway, and that is why it's called super highway, guys. Then comes the national highways. See, super highways are not everywhere, and they're not connecting every part of the country, but national highways are, and that makes it a very, very extremely important part of the country, because it is connecting the extreme parts of the country, right? And that makes it also the primary road system. Before the super highways, the district roadways, BRO, anything else, national highway becomes the primary road system, because no matter where you're going from, you will at least once pass through the national highways. Now, this is constructed and maintained by the Central Public Works Departments. Guys, just remember Public Works Departments, and you just have to remember the national, because it is national on the level of country, is developed by the center. And when it comes to state, the Public Works Departments, the department still remains the same, just from center it becomes state. This is just a trick to remember it, okay? Now, examples of this is NH1, NH2, NH7, etc. Guys, a very important one mark question could be, from where to where is NH1 running, or when did it start, where does it start from? So please do tell me about NH1, whatever you know. Moving on to state highways, guys, what is the purpose of the state highways? We understood that the Golden Quadrilateral has decreased the amount of time that was being consumed in connecting all these places. Traveling from north to south was going to take so much of time earlier, because you had to take so many deviations. Now the corridor has cut short the time and made the travel so easy. We know national highways are the primary mode of roadways, and they're connecting extreme parts of the country. But what are state highways doing? But yeah, they are basically, you could say, connecting extreme parts in the state. They connect the state capital to the different districts of the state. Okay, and as I told you, it is constructed and maintained by same PWD, Public Works Departments, but over here it will be of state. Then comes district roads. You just have to put it a little lower, just like how state capitals were being linked with the district headquarters. When you go a level lower, the district headquarters will be connected to the different parts of the districts, the different villages or rural areas or countrysides in the district. And who maintains this? District is under the control of local bodies, Zilla Parishad. So that's who maintains the district highways. Then we have other roads, bacha, which does not qualify in any of these categories. So you can just simply say that the rural areas and villages and towns are connected by these other roads. Now they are constructed under Pradhan Mantri Grameen Sadak Yojana. Now bacha, this scheme, the idea of going ahead with the scheme was to connect every village to at least the biggest, you know, some cities and towns, link it to the major towns nearby in the entire country with the kind of roads which are motorable through all the seasons, so that the access of the village and the linkage of the village through all these towns are maintained throughout the year. And special provisions are given under the scheme in order to ensure this. And then comes border roads, which is maintained by border roads organization. But these roads are of very strategic importance, because obviously they are at the border, right? And they are kind of connecting us with our neighboring countries, with our different countries, with the different countries around our nation, our country around India, which makes it very, very important, especially in areas like northeast and north, where we have neighboring countries. In south, it's mostly water, so it doesn't matter as much. Now also, on the basis of the materials that is used to build roads can be divided in two parts: metal roads and unmetal roads. Metal roads are, bacha, basically the pakka sadak, pakka roads that we see, which is made up of cement, concrete and bitumen of coal. And these are all weather roads. You can use them no matter whether it is monsoon, winter, summer. But that is not the case with the unmetal roads, because they are kaccha roads. They are not solid roads. They are made up of sand, soil, crushed rocks, clay, etc., which makes them not so accessible during the monsoon or rainy season. They are probably more accessible and feasible to be used only in the dry seasons. Okay, with that we have finished the roadways. Let's quickly move to railways. Bacha, what are the advantages of railways? The first thing that comes into my mind, and I remember when I first studied about industrialization, it always said that with railways the industrialization took a boon, and that also ultimately gave a push to urbanization, because industrialization and urbanization go hand in hand. Why is that? Because train has always been one of the most economical methods and less time consuming in terms of carrying bulks of weights and goods and people for that matter from one place to another place, with which it is also integrating the entire nation for more than 150 years. So whenever you want to take big, huge, bulky weights, it is for long distances, it is the excellent mode of transportation to opt for both goods and passengers. It is the largest public sector undertaking in the entire country, and in fact It binds the economic life and accelerates the development of the industry and agriculture at the same time. Simple, guys. It transfers people from here to there. It transfers the goods from here to there. So naturally, it is giving a boost to the different kinds of sectors in terms of industries, right? And factories, or you could say, in general, when it comes to economy, sectors of economy, right? And this by this, we have 16 zones, recognized zones of railways in India. I'm not sure if you knew this, but the first train was actually steamed off from Mumbai to Thane, covering a distance of 34 kilometers in 1853. And from there to here, where we have 17 railway zones, is the kind of transformation and development we have had. You might be thinking, ma'am, in the previous slide you said 16, you're saying 617 over here, because bachcha, the Konkan zone is not really counted in all these zones. If you count that, it becomes 17. Now, this is a chart that is given in your NCERT, and there's no description given about this. So let me quickly tell you about what is broad gauge, meter gauge, and narrow gauge. But your gauges are basically defined in the terms of what is the distance between the two railway tracks, right? The two tracks, how far are they? If they are above 1 meter, then they are known as broad. They're more broad gauges. If it is exactly 1 meter, then it becomes meter gauge. And below 1 meter, as you can see over here, is a narrow gauge. The most ideal one is broad gauge, and the government is constantly trying to transform all the tracks into broad gauges now, from narrow or meter gauge, because it is way easier and you could say ideal for transferring of bulky goods. That's the perfect gauge to have. But at the same time, the challenges have to be there. So what are the challenges that we face with Indian railways? See, first of all, India is a very diverse country, and at the same time, it has a very diverse landmass. It has a very diverse relief also. We have mountains, we have hills, we have sand, we have desert, we have rivers, which makes it very, very difficult to put in the railway lines, to lay the railway lines. At the same time, because of the rivers, especially in the northern and the eastern areas, building up those bridges and running the railway becomes challenging. In places where there is water, the tracks sink a lot of time, or with the landslides also, they are not in place, and it just becomes very, very problematic. At the same time, the cost that goes into this, guys, we discussed initially during roadways itself, that the building and maintenance of railways is expensive. So that's another problem. But that is in terms of development and building and maintenance. But when it comes to the kind of passengers who are traveling, how it is maintained after that as a responsibility of citizens, we pretty suck at that. We're not so great. As you guys would have seen, that the passengers who travel, most of them would travel without tickets, call heckling other people, or causing trouble to other people. At the same time, they do not respect the property as a public property, and they damage it. They sometimes steal things from there. They would just break it or exploit all these resources or facilities given in there. A lot of people, just for fun, for no reason, would also pull the chain, and all of this ultimately causes heavy damages to the railway and makes it not so safe, and discourages the passengers to take this as a means of transport. Now let's move to the third type of land transportation, which is a new arrival on the map of transportation. When we take the transportation map of India, pipelines was not there earlier. Guys, it is basically used to transport, earlier the pipelines were used to transport water from one city to another city. But now we're using it to transport the crude oils, petroleum, natural gases, iron ore, etc. The setting up cost of pipelines is definitely expensive, but maintenance as such is not. Running takes very little amount of resources, consumes very little amount of capital. Always remember that. In fact, we can even send transport some solid materials if they are changed, if they are converted into semi-solid, which is also known as slurry. You can also transport solid materials through these pipelines. If I talk about inland locations which are using pipelines, we have it in Barauni, Mathura, Panipat, etc. Guys, remember one very important point, which is the pipelines helps us a lot in reducing the transshipment losses or delays. What happens in roadways, railways, everywhere there is traffic, there is congestion, and ultimately there might be some delay, which may also ruin the goods that we are trying to send, or there are a lot of losses that's caused, right? When you transfer petrol from one place to another, accidents or some losses, some shipment hazards happen. But with pipeline, you are actually avoiding all of this. You're getting away from all of these. These are few important pipeline networks in India. We have from Upper Assam to Kanpur in UP, then from Salaya in Gujarat to Jalandhar, and from Hazira in Gujarat to Jagdishpur. Next, we come to waterways. The byways do not have any concept such, so we are not going to discuss it. Let's quickly move to waterways. But yeah, India has always been using waterways right from ancient times. Our people who used to travel through sea have traveled different countries, spreading Indian culture, spreading Indian commerce, spreading Indian language, everything by the means of water right from the beginning. But the weird part is that it only constitutes 1% of the total transportation that exists in India. But despite, and why is it more weird and astonishing is because it is the cheapest method. Not just that, it is very fuel efficient, and that is what makes it cheap, but at the same time economical or cheap, you could say. But at the same time, it is very environmental friendly also. When it comes to the kind of pollution that every other means of transportation does, waterways is very, very less in that. At the same time, because of the way it is designed and the kind of amount of goods that it can carry is just marvelous. It is just absolutely ideal for carrying huge, bulky, heavy goods from one place to the other. We have around 14,500 kilometers of water, you know, navigable water in here. But out of that, only 5,685 kilometers of water is navigable by mechanized vessels. Now, otherwise, it's more of manual and it's not possible to go ahead with all of it. Now, these following are few of the waterways that have been declared as national waterways by the government. NW1 being from Allahabad to Haldia, which runs for 1,620 kilometers, making it the longest inland waterway in India. Second one from Sadia to Dhubri, which is basically in Assam. This has helped Assam in developing their commerce and trading a lot. Then, of course, from West Coast Canal in Kerala, which is for 205 kilometers. Then NF4 is parts of Krishna and Godavari River of Kakinada to Puducherry stretch of canals, which is 1,078 kilometers. And the fifth one being parts of Brahmani River along with Mada River, delta channels of Mahanadi and Brahmani rivers, and East Coast Bengal of 588 kilometers. Guys, in India, the coastline, if I talk about the total coastline, as you can see right from west to east, is of 7,516.6 kilometers. On this, we have some 12 major ports. Apart from that, two small ports we have here and there everywhere, which are the minor ports and are, or you could also say the intermediate ports and are not of such economical or in general of such importance. But all of this has helped us a lot in increasing the international trade, in increasing India's foreign trade, and actually carries 95% of its total, the total bulk of India's foreign trade. Now let's quickly discuss about these important ports. One of the ports that's not listed over here is Mumbai port, but it is one of the oldest, biggest and the most spacious, natural and well-sheltered harbor in India. Okay, so that's what you basically need to understand for Mumbai, and is one of the most busiest ports in India. In fact, a lot of other ports here and there closer to Mumbai were built in order to reduce the traffic from Mumbai. So let's start by discussing about Kandla in Kutch. It was actually the first port that was developed immediately after independence. The idea was definitely to ease the, as I told you, the traffic or the trade, the volume of trade that was happening in Mumbai airport. But that was not the only reason. After independence, we lost our one port to Pakistan, which was the Karachi port, which was of great significance, guys. So this somewhere was built to, in memory of that. Now it just not only helps us in handling the export or imports from the foreign countries, but it also does help and plays a lot of like immensely important role in terms of inland transportation through waterways to Jammu Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan, etc. Okay, then comes the Jawaharlal Nehru port that was planned with a view to decongest the Mumbai port. Guys, can you see Kandla is doing the same thing? Jawaharlal Nehru port is also doing the same thing, and that is why it serves as a hub. It serves as a hub port for that particular region. Okay, then comes our Goa Airport, which is a premier iron ore exporting port of the country. You wouldn't believe, but around 50% of the total iron ore production that we have is actually exported through this one port alone. Then comes our New Mangalore Port, Bacha. This one is also actually exporting mostly the iron ore, which is produced, which it concentrates or gets from the Kudremukh mines. Now, this Kudremukh mine is one of the largest mine ores, one of the largest ores in India, in fact, in Asia for that matter. And the whole production from here is transported through this particular port. Guys, you would remember we have already discussed that what is the ideal case scenario of a factory to set up. The transportation should be there, the resource should be there, right? So all of these things are suitable. You will, if you notice, you will see that the ores, the transportation port, all of these are all nearby, and that's why a lot of industries of this field will also spring up in this region only. Then comes our Kochi, which is the extreme southwestern port. It is right at the entrance of the lagoon in Kerala. It is a natural harbor just like Mumbai. Right opposite to Kochi is our Tuticorin port. It is in the most southwestern corner, and this is in the southeastern corner, right? Just like Kochi or Mumbai, you could say this also has a natural harbor, and it is rich as rich hinterland. But yeah, this particular port handles a lot of, you could say, variety of cargoes, which is going to our neighboring countries in the southern region, the Maldives, Sri Lanka, etc. Okay, after that we come to Chennai, which is one of the oldest artificial ports. So we have just been discussing which are the natural harbors. Chennai is actually not one of those. It is a man-made, and that to the oldest, one of the oldest ports in our country. Now, just like Mumbai, in terms of the volume, traffic and congestion, it has huge, huge volumes. And that is why another few ports were built here and there close to it also, in order to reduce the you could say traffic over here. Visakhapatnam is another one, which is the deepest landlocked, which means it has land around everywhere, but there's a port over there, and that also makes it well protected port. Then we have Paradip Port, which is located in Odisha, which specializes in again export of iron. So all the iron that is extracted or produced from Chota Nagpur Plateau is actually exported through Odisha. Then we have Kolkata, which is an inland riverine port. But what do we mean by inland? Inland, as I told you, I would have discussed in waterway. So inland bacha basically means within the land of the country, within the boundaries of the country, from one state to another state, from one city to another city of India only. Overseas are the type of waterways where it travels from India to any other country through the medium of waterways, as I told you. Now, Kolkata is also a very large, very rich hinterland of Ganga Brahmaputra Basin. Okay, it's a large, huge airport, but it completely depends on it. I mean, like, it's basically a tidal port, which means it depends on the tides for its water level. Its water level completely depends on the tides. If it's high, the water level would be higher. If it's low, the water level would be lower. And because of this, it requires a lot of dredging to clear all the bed of to clear to keep clearing the bed of it by Hooghly. Now, if you do not know what you mean by dredging, but just see what happens whenever water comes. It comes with a lot of garbage, carrying a lot of garbage like weed, mud, and you could say rubbish. So just the dust on and then the different garbages disposed in water, it brings all of that to the surface. That happens naturally with tide. So we need something to wash it off the surface for it to be, you know, for the harbor, for it to be a good port. So that is what the purpose that is served by Hooghly. Okay, then we have Haldia Port. The idea of building the Haldia Port near Kolkata was again to reduce the pressure on our Kolkata port. With that, guys, we are done with waterways. Let's quickly move to airways. Guys, it's not going to take us a lot of time to discuss airways. It's pretty simple. See, there's simple pros and cons. Pros: fastest. No matter how long the distance is, it is the fastest, most comfortable, and one of the most prestigious, respectable ways of transport, right? It is very safe in terms of your individual safety, personal safety, which does not happen with roadways and railways as much. Of course, there's also one more thing, that no matter how difficult the terrain is, what area it is, whether it is forest, whether it is river or mountain, you can easily pass that area through the airways. But it comes with a lot of with few cons also. First of all, it is not cheap. It is not affordable by a normal human being and by a general, you know, middle class or lower middle class human being person, which is the general maximum crowd, majority crowd of our country, right? At the same time, there's a luggage constraint also. Through railways, even through roadways, and for that matter, with waterways, you can carry huge bulks of and heavy goods, and that too at a very good price, at a very economical price. But that is not at all the case with airways. If you, first of all, you cannot carry such huge bulks of goods, but let's say even if you are able to do it, becomes very, very cost consuming. But airways have helped us a lot in making our life easier in the northeastern part of our country, right? Because all this area especially, it has all the geographical features which makes it more difficult to have waterways. Is not at all possible, there's no water around there. But for the roadways also, the landways also, it gets pretty difficult because of the rivers, the dissected relief, the mountains, the forests, all of it. And then of course the kind of weather it has, because of the rivers and everything, there are frequent floods, there are international frontiers, boundaries over at that end. So the safest and the best method over here becomes the air travel, and that is what has made all of these areas easily accessible for all of us. So although it is not cheap for everyone, but in the northeastern it has kind of been subsidized for the more, to increase the accessibility of the people over there, because there is no other means of transport easily available for people. But then we have two kinds of services. One is domestic, one is international. Simple, within the boundary, within the country, within the nation, from one state to another, one city to another, is domestic service. For example, from Mumbai to Pune, Pune to Bangalore, Bangalore to Delhi, Delhi to Ranchi, wherever, is a domestic travel. So over here we have Indian Airlines, Alliance Air, private scheduled airlines and non-scheduled operators. Also in international services, from India to any other country, even if Pakistan, Chennai, Nepal, whatever you take, it becomes international. Whenever you're crossing the borders of your country, Air India is one of these. Okay. Then let's quickly talk about Pawan Hans Helicopters. What do you mean by this? Who are they? Bacha, Pawan Hans Helicopter Limited provides the services to our ONGC, Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, in its offshore operations to inaccessible areas and difficult terrains. Not just that, even in Northeast, they have definitely played a very important role, along with that in the interior parts of Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. With that, we are done with transportation. Let's quickly move to communication. What do we mean by communication, bachcha? The act of exchanging information, the act of exchanging information or message between two people, two entities, is known as communication. Right from the time that humans appeared on earth, they have tried to use different ways of communicating with each other. Because for us, for humans, exchanging the message, exchanging the information is very, very important. It becomes it becomes very essential. So that is what communication is. It could be of two types, but it could be personal in nature or it could be mass communication. It's very simple. Personal, individual, right? So when one-on-one exchange is happening, it is known as personal. When a mass is being addressed, when a whole group is being addressed, then that is known as mass communication, which we will discuss further in more detail. But you always remember that with all of this development, with all of these development in terms of science and technology and the progress that we have had, the long distance communication has now become very easier without a person moving physically from one place to another place. If you think of earlier times, it was so very difficult for people to move from one place to another place, right? Or just in simple ways to transfer or exchange their messages. People, when used to write a letter, either a crow or a pigeon used to take it, or a person used to go and deliver it, and it had to be done physically, and it was very difficult if people were not close to each other. But now personal communication has become very, very easy. It is a process where two people are transmitting messages between each other, right? Now you can do it through letters, mobile phones, messages, WhatsApps, internet. You have so many things, so many platforms, right? Now guys, there are also certain mail channels, which mean, what do you mean by mail? Letters that we send, the documents that we basically use through the process of posting, right? All of these is being tried to be facilitated in order to make all of this process quick through different mail channels in India. Few of these are Metro Channel, Green Channel, Business Channel, etc. Okay, guys, if we talk about the Indian Postal Network, when you physically want to send something and you're not transmitting it through the mobile phones, internet, and all these platforms, then we use Indian Postal Network to properly physically go and post a particular document or letter or anything that you want to send. In fact, I want you to know that India's postal network is the largest in the entire world. It handles everything right from letters to parcels, everything, right? And it's actually under the Ministry of Communication and Information Technology. Now, there are two kinds of mails in India, bacha. First one is first class and the second one is second class. First class mails constitutes of basically postcards, inland letter forms, envelopes, etc. Now, as the name suggests, the transportation services to given to it is also first class, which are the airways. Second class mail are basically books, parcel, registered newspapers, periodicals, etc., which gets the second class of transportation, which is the surface or the waterways. With that, now we will move to telecom networks. India, guys, so India has so much, I mean, like the amount of population, if you see the number of people that we have here, in general makes us largest in most of the things, okay? So when in telecom networks, we have the largest telecom network in the entire Asia, not in the world, but definitely in Asia. Now, even the government is trying to strengthen all of this right from the grassroots level to right up to the higher level, okay? Bilkul grassroots level se shuru karke high level tak jane ki koshish ki ja rahi hai. And how is this being made possible? By providing special provisions like 24-hour subscriber trunk dialing, that is the SST, STD facility to every village in the country. Otherwise, the villages were not having these services earlier, but the government is trying their best to achieve this, to enhance this in terms of, you know, development right from the basic level to the highest level possible. Now, static landline and mobile services have been improved to ensure faster personal communication, and this would definitely have not been possible. It has been possible because of the integration of all of the development in the space technology with the communication technology, right? So that is telecom networks, guys. With that, we come to mass communication. As I told you, whenever you want to transmit, whenever you want to give information to a huge chunk of people, large group of people, masses, that is known as mass communication. Now, the purpose of mass communication is not necessary to only provide the information or pass a message. It could also be to entertain them, to update them with the news, to make them aware, to inform them about different programs and policies of the country, etc., right? So it includes a lot of things. It's quite vast. It has radio, televisions, internet, periodicals, magazines, books, and films. Now let's talk about each of these quickly. If we talk about television and radios, guys, few important and popular channels, All India Radio in terms of radio and Doordarshan in terms of television. In fact, Doordarshan is one of the largest terrestrial networks in the world, which broadcasts multiple programs of national, regional and local languages, entertaining people, making them aware, informing them about the programs and policies, and making them aware of the world and the nation in itself. Then we have newspaper, periodicals and magazines. In India, we have all of these published in more than 100 languages and dialects. The most common, the largest production, publication happens in Hindi, English and Urdu. And the periodicals and magazines also are published in large numbers. Films, I think, goes unsaid. We all know that it is a huge network. India is the largest producer of feature films in the world. Central Board of Film Certification is the authority to certify both Indian and foreign films. With that, we now come to international trade. What is trade, first of all? Whenever we are exchanging goods, services, all of these things for a certain amount of economical value, for some money, between people, between countries, between states, that is known as trading, right? Now, trading can be done through any means of transportation, which are through sea, through air, through land. We already know that, and that is how it is also helping us go ahead and progress, right? Now, what is international trade? What do we mean by international trade? Naturally, when the trading happens between two countries, two nations, two different nations, two different countries, that is known as international trade. Now see, the more international trade is happening, the more you're exporting, more you're import, not import, actually export or import in general together, the amount of international trade you're doing, that is somewhere taken as a parameter, as an index to determine the economical prosperity, the progress, the development in terms of economical status of a country. That is what is taken as an index, as an indicator. Okay, now what is export and import? Bacha, when you're sending out goods, which means when you're selling goods to another country, that is export. When you're buying from another countries, when you're getting their materials to be sold within the countries, that is import. With that, we come to a new term called balance of trade. Now, what is balance of trade? The difference between the import and the export is known as balance of trade. Now, which is favorable, which is not favorable? See, this is how you will understand. See, whenever I'm selling stuff, I'm getting more money. But whenever I'm buying stuff, I'm spending more money, which is idle. Obviously, getting more money than spending more money. So, which is more favorable? When I'm getting more money, that is favorable, and when spending more money, that is unfavorable. So, when do I get money? When I export. So, when I export, it is a favorable balance trade. When I import, it is an unfavorable balance of trade. Okay, now India has large, the trade relations. If you talk about, we have major trading blocks in all and all geographical regions of the world. We have huge connections. We have taken globalization very, very seriously. What do we export and import, Bacha? The commodities, the goods and services that we export are gems, jewelry, chemicals, related products, etc. If we talk about what we import, petroleum, crude products, gems and jewelries, chemicals, related products, etc. Obviously, what we have in abundance, like spices, cotton, some minerals, we can easily send it off to the other people. But what we do not have, like petroleum, crude, it's not, we are not so rich in the terms of this, that we import from other countries. Recently, we have also emerged as a software giant, right, at an international level. And that is from where we are also earning a huge foreign exchange through our software industry, through our export of information technology. Now we come to the last part of today's lesson, which is tourism as trade. Much of tourism has seen a boost in the past 30 years. Earlier, people were not so much into traveling. Also, because the methods or the means of transportation were not so developed. But even after that, in past 30 years, the whole scenario of transportation has completely changed. Now, almost 15 million of people are directly or indirectly engaged in the tourism industry. That's the kind of impact it has. And at the same time, has multiple advantages of it, right? It definitely promotes integration in terms of the nation itself. It promotes the exchange of culture. Cultures, right? Globalization, integration with the other parts of the country, world also. It provides support to the local handicrafts and cultural pursuits. Helps in development of international understanding about our culture and heritage. Rajasthan, Goa, Jammu and Kashmir, temple towns of South India, a few important tourist destinations. Foreign tourists visit India for the heritage tourism, ecotourism, adventure tourism, etc. Guys, the scenario of tourism right now in different country, in different states of India is pretty amazing. I wouldn't say it's bad, right? But we still have a huge potential which has not been explored. We still have a vast window for more and more development, for more and more improvement, for more and more upskilling in different types of, with all of this, we need to make a lot of efforts in order to promote the different types of tourism that is happening right now. And this is an upcoming industry. This is going to change the face of economy of any country. So if we properly work hard towards it and make all of these efforts and changes, we are super sorted and we're going to get a lot of money through this. With this, we have come to the end of the session, people. Let's quickly look at your homework question. Which one of the following is the oldest port in eastern coast of India? Kolkata, Haldia, Visakhapatnam, Tuticorin, or Chennai, that is Madras. Do not forget to like the videos, guys, because I'm sure with this we have completed this chapter and you would be super excited. You have already bagged all the marks which this chapter is carrying. Also, do not forget to subscribe to the channel if you have not already, so that with the next session you get the notification immediately. Do tell me in the comment section, guys, how did you like the video? But more importantly, do not forget to drop in your doubts in here, because for your doubt and mentee session, that is where I will be picking your doubts from. And now I will see you guys in the next session. Till then, stay home, stay safe, guys. Take good care of yourself. Bye, people.